Everyone, thank you so much for coming. It's so exciting to meet all of my fellow Girl Geeks here in the Bay Area. And yeah, again, thank you to Girl Geeks for working with us on pulling this event together. So I want this to be as useful for you guys as possible, so we're going to pass the microphone around at the end, so please think of any questions. If you have anything, like, you can also just raise your hand and I will be happy to answer anything. I think the best place to start is probably back in 2002, which is when my then boyfriend, now husband, Eric, who's at the back of the room there, when we founded ModCloth together. I guess we can go back even further. So I've always loved fashion. I've always loved vintage clothing. It's always been something that I've been very passionate about. You know, I kind of remember at a young age having an opinion on sort of which pair of shoes I wanted to buy, you know, when my mom took me to buy my annual pair of shoes. I've always been into vintage and thrifting, and my mom and my grandmother used to take me. At a very young age, I learned kind of the thrill of the hunt and finding an amazing bargain and finding a great piece at a thrift store. And I actually grew up in South Florida, so I'm a Florida girl. And I got into school at Carnegie Mellon University in Pittsburgh, so I was basically facing my first winter ever. I didn't have coats or scarves or hats or any of those things that you need when you live in the Northeast. So I was thrifting even more than usual, and when I started looking for winter wear, I realized that there was such amazing, amazing stuff, because it's South Florida, all the retirees come down, and everyone unloads, and no one was really buying the winter wear at that point. So my closet got really, really big, so I just couldn't pass a beautiful piece of clothing. So I'd buy it and say, like, oh, you know, maybe it'll fit one of my friends, or maybe I'll learn how to sew and actually tailor it to fit me, which still hasn't happened, by the way, kind of embarrassingly. I'll use the buttons for something, I'll use it for a craft project, you know, there are all these things, but mostly it just kind of went into the closet and it got bigger and bigger. And Eric was like, you know, I could help you start a website to sell some of this stuff. And for me, that sounded like a really great idea. I love the challenge of it, and I love the idea that, you know, someone else would actually get to enjoy these garments, that they would go to someone who would really love them and who would care for them and actually wear them rather than I'm just sitting in my closet. So we built the site during that summer between high school and college. So I sourced all of the inventory. My parents actually gave me a digital camera for my high school graduation gift, which was very fortunate. So I kind of learned how to merchandise everything, and, you know, we found this actually really horrible plastic, like, large, like, curvaceous mannequin at the thrift store that I'm pretty sure was, like, usually like on a boardwalk or something. She's still somewhere. My mom would get really freaked out when I'd have her in my room, because it kind of, when you walk in at night, it kind of seems like there's a person there. So we actually built the site on a open source shopping e-commerce platform. Eric had started his first business when he was 16, which is a web hosting and web development business. So I taught myself Photoshop, taught myself a little bit of HTML, used Microsoft Front Page to build the first version of the site. Yes. And if you go to the Wayback When machine, I think you can find the old ModCloth logo, the original one. It definitely looks like it was designed by a 17-year-old with no design experience. But it was such a fun process, and, you know, I was really hooked. So when we launched in January of 2003, actually during winter break, and we had a sale on our first day. And it was just so exciting. Like, I was definitely bit by the entrepreneurial bug. I'm like, wow, I can actually go out there and find pieces. People are actually interested in them. Someone in the world out there actually bought a ModCloth item. This is amazing. So something that I did part-time while I was at school, I was a business major, business and German double major at Carnegie Mellon. In all of my spare time, of course, you know, you have tons of that as a college student, weekends and, you know, spring break and, like, sometimes in the evenings, I worked on finding new inventory and photographing it, and, you know, I was the customer care department. It was basically a one-woman operation. So the customer care line on the website was actually my cell phone number. Sometimes I'd have to leave the library and I'd be like, you know, thanks for calling ModCloth. How can I help you? I was trying to feel a little bit bigger than we were. And, you know, I realized that the site was really growing. So year after year, I continued to work on it during summer vacation, spent a lot of time. We actually, I think it was in 2005, we like redid the site and redesigned it. We created a new logo. We switched from, I think we were originally on the Interchange shopping cart, and we then switched to OS Commerce. So it was kind of a big deal for us, very exciting at the time. And we, you know, I realized in 2005 when I was approaching graduation that I really had something, that there were a lot of people coming to the website. I think we had something like 70,000 unique visitors a month at that point. And, you know, I kind of thought, like, wow, I would never be able to open up a store, you know, at least in Pittsburgh, that had 70,000 people coming to it every month. That's probably something really special. And it feels like, you know, we're doing something that's unique and we're filling a hole in the market in a way that no one else has yet. So we, in 2005, we realized that our one-of-a-kind vintage business model wasn't the best. We actually polled our customers as part of a marketing class. We got some of our classmates to help us. Our business was like I forget what the project was, but it was some sort of like, marketing customer poll, and most people were using like case studies. We were actually using our own business, which was kind of cool. So we went and we called 100 of our customers. We asked them if the clothing on ModCloth was independently designed, you know, vintage and retro inspired rather than actual one-of-a-kind vintage, would you still be interested in it? And I think it was like 98 of them said yes. So we raised our first round of seed capital. So we went to two of Eric's uncles and they invested, I think it was like $5,000 each at that point. Up till that point, it was entirely self-funded. So it was just, you know, we were going to the thrift store and things were, our inventory costs were pretty low. And, you know, we were just, we basically did everything between the two of us. We used a free open source shopping cart and, you know, did our own design and all that stuff. So we, in 2005, I spent the whole summer researching, like, where do I find these designers? I was based in Pittsburgh. I really didn't have any connection to the industry. And I honestly just didn't know how to get involved. So I literally searched like wholesale clothing designers on Google and, you know, tried to figure out like, where do I go? What trade shows do I go to? Like, how do we do this? And we went to the Magic trade show in February 2006 for the first time. And I went out and I sourced independent designers that had kind of a similar feel. And that's when ModCloth really started to look like what it looks like today. So if you go to ModCloth today, you'll see designs from over 700 different independent designers. A lot of them are based in Southern California, but all over the country and all over the world. We work with a lot of international designers now too. And we do still sell one-of-a-kind vintage, but those pieces generally go very, very quickly. We do at least one a day, and they usually sell out within 5 or 10 minutes or so because they are so rare. But you can follow us on Twitter to see them. Just a little plug there. So we went out, we found independent designers, we started to really build the site, develop the look and feel of it. I graduated in 2006 and started working on the business full time. And at that point, you know, it was just, I looked at all of my peers going off to the Career Center and kind of getting real world jobs, and I just couldn't imagine anything that would be as fun and as rewarding as ModCloth. And it was definitely a scary proposition. I would say that my parents weren't too thrilled with the fact that I was going to be working on ModCloth and, you know, not actually having a guaranteed salary and with student loans coming through. You guys know that story probably. Like I said, it was so rewarding and so fun to be able to work on it. And I kind of figured, like, I think this could be really big, but, you know, if I can just support myself and I'm doing something that I love, then, you know, I feel good about that. So it really was kind of like in bits and pieces as we continued to grow. So I hired my first employees in 2006. Eric joined full-time in 2007, the next year. And we just continued to see the site really, really grow and to see, see more customers come. We saw our cohort analysis stay really strong. So the customers that had come in previous years continued to come back. And we saw that she was telling her friends. So that was really exciting. We actually bought a house in Pittsburgh, and we were running the business out of our house. So previous to this, it was in my dorm room, and then in our college house, we were shipping out of our basement. Our first part-time employee was a friend who just came over and helped us box everything up. But we bought this big, like, 8-bedroom house in Pittsburgh, and we had our distribution center in the basement and our, like, conference room, and our tech team was on the first floor. We had our offices and our photo studio on the second floor, and then we lived on the third floor, and we had some roommates in there, too. By the end of it, I think we had 14 people coming in and out of the house with the full-time employees and the roommates' boyfriends or girlfriends that ended up sleeping there. So it was kind of crazy. There was never a clean fork. It showed me nuts. So in April of 2008, we moved out into our first real office space, and that was a really big step for the business. I think for me personally as an entrepreneur, it was really good to at least have that separation between my personal life and my professional life, and I felt really, really good that we were finally at that stage where we were, you know, legit running our own office space. And then in June of 2008, we raised our first round of institutional capital, and I think that it really helped us. We were able to, up until that point, we were able to really just use like friends and family capital and bootstrap ourselves. Probably incredibly risky. We took a lot of personal risk and crazy. You know, this was like 2006, 2007, so before the economy crashed, so we were able to get, like, you know, lots of credit card debt and student loans and those sorts of things that probably wouldn't happen the same way today. But, you know, we figured, like, we're young, worst comes to worst, we're talented, we'll go out and get other jobs. Like, this is worth really pursuing and, like, putting everything on the line for. So in June of 2008, we raised our first institutional round. It's a very big step for us, and part of what we pitched was that we were, you know, we'd made the decision a few months earlier to start building our own in-house platform. So we looked at the business, we looked at kind of our options on the market, and it was like, okay, we'll stay with an open source shopping cart that has never really supported a business that is as big as what we want to get, or work with someone really big like IBM, and that didn't seem like the right choice either, because we had a lot of ideas to really make the shopping experience more social and very different. So part of how we raise capital is pitching, you know, we're going to be building our own shopping cart, we're going to be fundamentally changing the way that you shop for creative goods online. And that vision is, you know, it's definitely shifted and changed. I'd say, like, a lot has changed since mid-2008 in this space. It's moving so, so quickly. But that fundamental core hasn't changed. Like, we are fundamentally changing how she shops. And I think that I feel like we've just gotten started. E-commerce is like such an interesting place and time to be right now because it's kind of like the whole paradigm has been built on books and electronics. You know, if you think about like finding the right camera for you, it's really, you know, you want to compare and you're probably just going to buy one and there probably is one that's actually exactly right for you. And then it's easy to say like, oh, I need the case that fits it. I need the charger. I need these things. But when you're shopping for something creative, if you're shopping for a dress, if you find two dresses that you love, you might buy both of them. You might not buy it all, but you should still have a really fun and engaging experience looking for those dresses. So it's just like, it's a totally different way of approaching it. And I think, you know, we're at ModCloth, we're all so, so excited to be, you know, working on this next stage of e-commerce and really, you know, making that paradigm shift. So we're in 2008. So we jump forward a little bit there. So we raised our first round of funding. We had an incredible year, just continued to see huge, huge success. I think we grew 6x year over year in sales from 2007 to 2008, and then again from 2008 to 2009. So we came out to the Bay Area, we met more investors, we raised a Series A1, continued to grow through 2009, and then coming into 2010, we were thinking about raising a Series B and kind of getting to a place where, you know, the business had continued to grow, but we felt like we were hitting some constraints, so we were still based entirely out of Pittsburgh, particularly in finding, like, building the great technology team that we needed and the great user experience team that we needed to make this vision of a new shopping, way of shopping a reality. So we actually raised our Series B, and part of the Series B was moving out to San Francisco and moving our headquarters here, and really starting to build out our tech team here. So it's been a really fun journey. I think that, yeah, we also, so part of that Series B, we also opened a buying office in LA. That's where I spend a lot of my time. I'm really passionate about the physical product that we sell. I also love the product that we're building on the tech side, but I really love being able to go and to work with the buying team and to work with our designers. And more we're making exclusive product just for ModCloth. We're working with them on programs like Be the Buyer, where we get their samples before they've actually committed to production, and we're able to, you know, give them real-time feedback from their customers rather than just from retail buyers, which is what they've gotten in the past. So it's been, yeah, like I said, it's been really incredible. I feel so, so lucky to be able to work on something that I'm so passionate about. And I would say, you know, especially for entrepreneurs, but I think in any walk of life, you know, when you do something that you're passionate about, it just makes, it's not work anymore. It's about like, yeah, it's about doing something that you love. And I would really put that out there. I think that's really, really important.